Good evening. Good evening. Much better. My name is Ira Weiss. I'm the Dean of the Poole College of Management, and it's my pleasure to welcome you this evening to tonight's John W. Pope Lecture. The Poole College of Management and the School of Public and International Affairs at NC State's College of Humanities and Social Sciences have hosted this annual conference, annual lecture, since 2005. The goal of this program is to encourage dialogue on topics of political and economic interest. Towards that end, the series has presented some of the nation's top economists and leaders in political science and public policy to provide insight and perspective on the complexities of today's global marketplace. This lecture series is part of the Foundations of Free Societies grant from the John W. Pope Foundation. That grant supports a student organization called SPEL, the Society for Politics, Economics, and Law. It also supports research by our undergraduate students, doctoral dissertations, faculty research, and of course, this lecture series. As always, this public lecture concludes a busy day for our speaker. Today, the speaker had breakfast with members of SPEL, met graduate students and faculty of both colleges, and this will be the finale of his day with us as he has a very early morning flight out tomorrow. You are encouraged to join in conversation with the speaker following his presentation at a reception that will be held downstairs in our Port City Java Commons on the second floor. Now I'll turn the microphone over to Professor Steve Margolis, Professor of Economics here at Poole, who will introduce tonight's speaker. Steve?
Thank you, Ira. Welcome to the somewhat delayed 2015 John W. Pope Lecture. I join Ira in acknowledging the contributions of the Pope Foundation. They've been with us this is our 11th year with the program, and Ira already explained to you some of the things we do under this grant. It's been a tremendous help for some of our undergraduates and our doctoral students who have been supported under this grant. And we're grateful for their support. Let me acknowledge my co-conspirator in this program, Andy Taylor, in political science, who has worked on this program with me, with us all this time. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker for tonight, John Taylor. John Taylor is the Mary and Robert Raymond Professor of Economics at Stanford University, and the George P. Schultz Senior Fellow in Economics at the Hoover Institution. Professor Taylor is among the most prominent economists of his generation, profoundly influencing both economic scholarship and public policy. He served as senior staff economist for President Ford's Council of Economic Advisors and as a member of the council during the George H.W. Bush administration. From 2001 to 2005, he served as Undersecretary of State of Treasury for International Affairs. Professor Taylor is known for the proposed rule for monetary policy, not surprisingly known as the Taylor Rule, which is widely used as both a guide to monetary policy and as a reference point for evaluating alternative monetary regimes. Professor Taylor stands out in four realms of economic practice. He's made essential contributions to the professional literature of economics. He has also written prominently for the general public. You'll see his writings in the Wall Street Journal and in the book, First Principles, which is partly the basis of his talk this evening. He's also played important roles in framing public policy during his work for government. And finally, he's a teacher. He teaches, among other things, the introductory economics course at Stanford. In his recent book, First Principles, Five Keys for Restoring America's Prosperity, Taylor puts forward five defining principles of economic freedom that offer a foundation for economic success. That phrase, principles of economic freedom, runs throughout the book and has been a theme of his visit with us today. As Ira mentioned, Professor Taylor's been with us all day. It's been a busy day, and this is the highlight. John, thank you so much for being with us tonight.
Thank you. You don't need that. Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Ira. Thank you all for coming. I'm looking forward to this. I've been looking forward to it for several months now. I originally was coming down here in February of this year. I was in Washington on a trip. I walked out of the Federal Reserve Building, and Steve was on the phone and said, John, I don't think you should come. What's wrong? Well, you got this snowstorm. What do you mean snowstorm? He meant a snowstorm. It was serious. So I didn't come. I went back to California, and we've been trying to find a mutually acceptable date, and I think we found one. Actually, I got a little confused when I sent my slides to Steve. I had October 30th on here, so it shows you how mixed up I am, but we were able to make the correction just before I start. So, as Professor Margolis was saying, I want to talk about sort of the principles that I think are so important to have a strong, prosperous economy. And these principles I've been teaching actually for many years, but they're kind of wrapped up in this way, which I think is useful for our current situation in the United States economy, and for that matter, as you'll see to some extent, in the whole global economy. So I want to start by just characterizing to you with a few charts where I think the US economy is. There's a lot of discussion and debate about that. And then argue some of the reasons why I think it has to do with policy is the reason where we are now, and then some prospects for making some changes. So that's what we're going to do. I'm going to start with this chart. It looks like an electrocardiogram. It's not. It's the US economy. It's real GDP growth from quarter to quarter back to the 1940s and to the present, most recent quarter. I divided this up into territories, a lot of volatility up until the early 80s, and a lot of stability through the early 2000s, and then a lot of instability again. In particular, that big dip is the Great Recession or the financial crisis that we went through in 2007, 2008, 2009. Now, when you look at this, these ups and downs are, of course, important, but you imagine a line drawn at zero, and when you go below that zero, those are recessions. So you can see we had quite a few recessions in the 60s and 70s until the early 80s, and they kind of diminished. That was this period sometimes called the Great Moderation in this period. Sometimes it's called NICE. NICE is for non-inflationary, consistently expansionary, a term coined by the governor of the Bank of England not so long ago because it seems so smooth. So a lot of people don't remember that period, but we hardly had a business cycle. We had minor recessions, and we had strong recoveries, and then this changed more recently. So one of the things we want to understand why that's the case, what's going on. And again, remember, this is just real GDP, the total amount of production of goods and services in a particular period adjusted for inflation in the United States. I'm going to circle a couple of things here to show you some of the problems in addition to that big dip in the Great Recession. And that is the slower growth we have now. So if you look at the early 80s, and right before that, you see lots, you have big downturns, like a double dip recession then in the early 80s. And then we had this recovery, which was pretty pronounced. If you look carefully, you see growth rates 6, 7, 8%, maybe 9% for a while in that period. And that was a substantial recovery, good recovery, and actually a fairly typical recovery from that kind of a recession. And then you look at this period over here, we have that dip down. Again, it's comparable to the early 80s. But in this case, we don't get a recovery in the same sense of the word. It's much slower. That red circle is considerably below the other red circle, and so growth is slow coming out of this recession. So that's, in a sense, that and the Great Recession itself are the problems that we have. It's not like we didn't have any recovery, you'll see in a minute. It's just been a not-so-great recovery. Another way to look at that is just look at real GDP itself. Forget the growth rate for a second. Just look at real GDP, and that's what this chart shows. It doesn't go back to the 1940s. It just goes back to 2007. And the blue line is real GDP. The vertical axis has billions of 2009 dollars, so that's corrected for inflation. And you can see the dip down, that's the recession. Real GDP actually fell. We produced less each year during that recession. And then we see the recovery, and you see real GDP growing again. So that's positive growth for the most part. There's hardly any, maybe a couple of minor dips negative in that direction, but not another recession. But what's problematic about this is if you just look at where we were going before this, that's what the green line is supposed to show. 2.5% growth, we haven't even caught up to that. In fact, the gap is getting slightly larger if we look carefully. So while we've been recovering, the recovery is not enough to bring us back to where we were. Now, I don't know for sure that 2.5% is correct, but that's where we were going before then. That's kind of the trend line that goes back a number of years before, just drawn here. In some sense, it's a measure of the economy's potential. Now, this is important because if we keep growing like this, our estimates of the economy's potential are going to start to go down. Our expectations will diminish. And in fact, if you look at what the Congressional Budget Office is saying now, they're the office of the in the Congress that has responsibility for forecasting the budget and estimating the impact of programs. They're actually forecasting now that we're off that 2.5% trend. We somehow missed it. And if it keeps growing, and quite frankly, if we don't get the economy growing more rapidly again, they're going to keep lowering that line until it meets. That's basically what they're going to do, because they'll say, hey, we're not growing. We must have a slower potential growth. But that is the new estimate of where we're going. Just by way of comparison, take a look at what happened in the early 1980s after a very deep recession. Here we see the real GDP in blue, and we see this measure of potential in red, and you see this catch-up just within 2 or 3 years. It seemed like a long time at the time, but it's nothing compared to what's happened this time. So we had these rapid growth, and in that period where you see the blue line pretty steep, that's that period of, again, 5, 6, 7, 8% growth. And we had nothing like that this time. So I think sometimes when I characterize this, we kind of missed a real recovery. We haven't had it yet. Hope we do, and that's one of the questions I want to address. This slow growth, again, it's good as growth, but it's slow, has impacts all over the place. And one impact I think is important is to think about the labor markets. Because if the economy is not growing rapidly, jobs are not growing rapidly, so it affects all of us. This is a picture that tries to describe that phenomenon. It's now looking at the months since the recession ended, which was back in 2009, and so it's going over. It's about 6 years, you can see, going over. It's months in the horizontal axis. And then I'm looking at something called the employment population ratio. So that just is the fraction of the working age population that's actually working, fraction of the population that's working. And this shows you how much that ratio has changed since the recession ended. And it compares two periods, the recent recovery and the recovery in the early 80s. The recent recovery is in blue, and as you see, it has not increased at all compared to the bottom of the recession. The bottom of the recession, we've had job growth, but the job growth has not been sufficient to increase the employment of the working age population. It's just growing at about the same pace as the number of people who want to work, who are available for work, I should say, available for work, the working age population. And compare that to the early 80s. I mean, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, almost 6% increase in that same period of time. So you had many more jobs being created per population, per person that could work. And that's because of the slow growth. I mean, there's other theories about this, but that's basically, I think, the slow growth. In this period, there's the population is aging, so part of that is people dropping out of the labor force because they're retiring. But for the most part, this is the slow recovery. Okay, so it's a phenomenon that's very profound and affects all of us. Now, the question is, why is this happening? And there's a number of different views out there. Oops. One view is characterized by this cover of the Economist magazine, which is to say the U.S. economy has lost its oomph, they call it, its ability to grow rapidly. And it's pictured by this jockey on top of a slow-moving turtle trying to get that turtle to go rapidly, go faster, and it doesn't. I get too rapid myself. It doesn't. And so we've lost the oomph. So nothing much we can do, just having slow growth for a while. And that's a view that a not insignificant number of people have at this point in time. Sometimes it's called secular stagnation, that the economy is just growing more slowly. And there's explanations, there's theories about why it might be the case. Investment opportunities drying up, things like that, or people saving too much, not enough consumption. There's various things that are going on that explain it, but that's the view. There's not much you can do. The other view, which I'm going to have by this crazy picture of an eagle, is that it's not a turtle. It's still an eagle. It's still the American eagle, if you like. It's just caged. It's caged by these policies that are not letting the economy grow and thrive as it did as much in certain periods of the past. Not all periods, of course, but in certain periods of the past. So that's the concept here. And I want to kind of talk about that, these two different views. I'm going to emphasize the caged eagle view, but I want to talk a little bit about the slow turtle view. One part of the slow turtle view is that this is typical of a period after a deep financial crisis. It sounds reasonable. You have a deep financial crisis, the economy is hit, and what do you expect but a slow recovery from that situation? Well, the truth is, if you look at American history, you expect a more rapid recovery in those situations. That's what this bar chart tries to show. It takes various recovery periods from deep recessions that are associated with financial crises that economic historians have designated, and it shows you the growth rate in the first 2 years, in this case, first 8 quarters of the recovery. The red line is the recovery we've had, this current recovery, in the first 2 years of that. And it's actually 2%, 2.2, it's still 2.2. It hasn't increased, you saw that in the previous charts, hasn't increased at all. The average of all the others is about 6. So it's a third as rapid. And there's other ways to do this, but this is the story. So you can't just say it's because we had a very unusual situation. In these situations, you expect faster growth. Another explanation is that in this recession, in the period going into it especially, people borrowed too much. Borrowed too much to buy houses, they borrowed too much to buy consumer goods. Firms borrowed too much to expand, and so they had this gigantic amount of debt. And to get rid of that debt, they had to deleverage, it's called, get that leverage down, deleverage. And deleveraging, how do you deleverage? You save. You save more than you're consuming so you could reduce your debt. So another explanation is this high level of debt requires deleveraging, which means that you have to have higher savings rates for a while, and that means lower consumption for a while, and that means slow growth for consumption. That's the explanation. This is a picture of the saving rate in these two different recoveries. The blue line meaning the most recent one, the red line meaning the other one. And you can see, according to the data, this is the US official data, the savings rate were actually higher in that fast recovery than in the recent one. So the notion that we're saving too much and therefore consumption growth is low is just not in the data. It doesn't really add up. Another explanation you sometimes read, it's kind of like an austerity problem. Government purchases haven't grown enough to stimulate the economy. They've slowed down. Well, they have slowed down, especially if you include state and local governments. And that picture is shown here by the blue line. But why have they? Has this some exogenous force that has caused purchases of goods and services by governments to slow? It's mainly the fact that revenues haven't grown so much in the slow recovery. So it's just another symptom of a slow recovery. So I say this is not an explanation earlier either. There's lots of other explanations that you can consider. But as I go through them all, I still come to the conclusion that it has to do with policy, that policy is the problem. And we have changed policies compared to what we had in earlier periods would work well. That's the whole point of my discussion tonight. Now, how do I describe this? I write a book. This is what Professor Margolis was talking about. First principles, And this is my attempt to explain in simple terms what I think is going on, but it all is related to policies off track. So what do I mean by first principles? First principles is simply a way for me to describe in simpler terms what I've been teaching to freshmen and sophomores for many, many years about economics and how the economy works. So I decided I'm going to choose a set of principles. I call the principles of economic freedom. And they're pretty straightforward. I think can't debate them too much, but here they are. First one is that people, individuals, families, entrepreneurs, are free to make decisions within these five conditions. One is that there's a predictable policy framework, and so you know what the policy is going to be. There's not a big guess about what tax policy or monetary policy or fiscal policy or regulatory policy will be. It's stable. You don't have to guess all the time. That's very important. If it's based on the rule of law, even better, because then you're not going to keep violating the rule of law or ignoring the rule of law. You have a system of laws, what it has to do with property or employment rights or what it happens to be. Second principle, very important principle that economists don't always stress enough compared to other principles, so that's why I put them first and second. And then third, emphasizing the incentives that people have to expand firms, to get educated better, to do well in the job, to advance, to, again, incentives to take care of their kids, all those things that are important for a thriving economy. And it's best of all if those incentives are based on the market system as much as you can, because we know that provides prices and an allocation mechanism, and prices do have the three roles, as you know, market system works. And finally, there's a limited role for government. And by limited role for government, I simply mean that there's some things that government does well, and there's some things the private sector does well. And you should do, as best you can, a thorough cost-benefit analysis of society does what? National defense, obviously, is a thing for government. But how far should it go? So cost-benefit analysis, limited role for government. I think that these principles are one of the reasons the United States economy has done so well over many, many years. I also think it's the reason why some emerging market countries are doing better in the last, say, 20, 30 years than they have in the past, if you go through. And I think if you go through and think of your economics textbooks, or economic courses, whenever you took them, you'll see something similar to this. But this is a way for me to just describe it in the simplest terms as I can. Now, what's interesting is that we've had shifts in these principles over time. I call them the shifting winds of economic freedom. And in the 60s and 70s, which I showed you in the beginning was a volatile period, a lot of recessions, unemployment was rising, inflation was rising, we tend to shift away from the principles. I'm going to show you a little bit more about that. Then, in the 80s and 90s, we kind of swung back to the principles. That was that great moderation thing that I showed you. And there's other ways to characterize that. Growth started to pick up, unemployment was basically coming down, as was inflation. And other things. Not a perfect time, and I'll talk about that too. Swung back towards the principles. And then I think more recently, this is my theory, we veered away from these principles again. And so that's the idea. And you can see this amazingly to me in all sorts of policies. I'm an expert, claim to be anyway, in monetary policy. You can see monetary policy so much different in the 70s. Probably don't remember, but go stop policy. Just put on the brakes, accelerate. A lot of discretionary changes. Inflation rose, unemployment rose. Monetary policy in the 80s and 90s until recently, pretty much the opposite. Paul Volcker was there, came in, appointed by President Carter, made a difference. And then more recently, in my view, it's kind of become erratic again, and that's one of the problems why the Great Recession occurred is also why the slow recovery is there. So there's a pattern. Can't summarize all of this, of course, but there's a pattern or a correlation between the performance and the policies. When I wrote this book, my publishers wanted me to name names who did this stuff, so I decided I'd write a chapter about who gets us in and out of these messes. Amazingly, it's a completely nonpartisan answer. Sometimes Republicans get us in, sometimes Republicans get us out, sometimes Democrats get us in, sometimes Democrats get us out. So, for example, this is a period where I think a lot of the interventions began in the 60s. A lot of that had to do with the philosophy of Keynesianism. It came a lot by people who got good influential positions in the administration, President Kennedy and then President Johnson. And they brought in a kind of an activist kind of policy. I don't think so predictable, less based on markets than before, more interventionist. Fiscal policy is some of the famous ones, but monetary policy too. There was a competing view at the time, very famous competing view by Milton Friedman, wrote a book called Capitalism and Freedom the same year as the first economic report of the president was written in the Kennedy administration. Completely different view, actually closer to the view that I'm suggesting now. Friedman lost, the others won, Keynesians won, and that's basically, if you like, the who gets us in and out of these messes. It was important to get the Fed to cooperate with this view, so William Chesney Martin was the chairman of the Fed, and then Arthur Burns was the chairman of the Fed, and they basically adopted these kinds of interventionist types of policies. Again, all well-meaning people. This is not an indictment of people's intentions. This is a criticism of the effects, getting the Fed to cooperate. One of the worst was the actions taken by President Nixon to impose wage and price controls across the whole economy. Talk about moving away from principles, not based on the market. Huge amount of intervention, highly unpredictable. Just all the things that you would complain about. And it was put in place for the whole economy. And this kind of thing continued into the 70s, I think. All these controls were not removed until the early 80s. And there were other elements of this, which we can discuss if you like. There was a sense of getting back from this, and it's interesting why. But I think pretty much in the late 70s, people got sick of this. Inflation rising, unemployment rising, slower growth, disappointing opportunities for students leaving school. And so there was some changes. Actually, one of the first changes was President Carter appoints Paul Volcker, both Democrats, in 1979, and begins to change things at the Fed. You had the beginning of kind of a deregulation movement, which is to get the government out of certain kinds of regulatory actions, Civil Aeronautics Board, for example, that didn't make sense. And so we started coming back. It affected monetary policy, as I indicated, because of some of the appointments, but also a change in philosophy that these interventions weren't working. And I think a demand, our democracy was working, I think of it, a demand that we make some changes. So monetary policy got involved. By the 1990s, President Clinton was saying the era of big government is over, a very famous speech. Some of the centralized welfare programs will devolve to the states. So that's a question of limiting the role of government to where the government works best. And that's a whole, across different political parties, but I think a different view than we had earlier. But then, unfortunately, we began to move back. We call it this activist revival. I don't know exactly when it occurred. I'm a monetary policy aficionado again. I began to see the Fed deviating from policy around 2003, 4, and 5. I'll show you a picture of that in a minute. And then it began in many other ways, too. We had fiscal stimulus packages. We had, if you think, no matter what you think about, a heavy re-regulation of the financial sector and a great deal of increased involvement of government in various activities. Who brought monetary activism back? I don't know. It began under Greenspan's term. He had a good record, but at the end of that. And then you have other people. 2008 stimulus package, that was the first attempt to goose the economy. It was done in President Bush's term. And then I call it doubling down, because then we had many more interventions, many more stimulus packages, much more active Federal Reserve, and then the re-regulation, and for that matter, the Affordable Care Act. Regardless of what you think about it, it was a much heavier involvement of the government in the private sector. So that's it. It's just a swing back and forth, a little bit of color, detail about what was going on. Now, what I'd like to do is show you a few charts that try to illustrate some of these things. Go through it so it's not just me talking about people. This is one chart which I think is indicative of the change in policy. It's just one of many. It's the ratio of federal debt to GDP going back to the founding of the United States in the late 1700s. And the debt to GDP ratio is kind of a measure of our ability to service our debt. You can see it's gone up in wars, a big one. Through most of my life, this was the biggest story. In World War II, the big increase in the debt, it came down again, and then it shows you the increase more recently, and then it finally shows you the projections of what is going to happen if we don't change the current law. Okay, and this is done by the Congressional Budget Office again, called the Extended Alternative Fiscal Scenario. That's a clever term. And then my extrapolation of that, it goes further into the future. This chart, I've always found it useful for teaching because it shows you what will happen in the future if we don't fix things. And back in, actually 2009, I put this chart up. It looked almost the same in 2009 because we really haven't done much about it. And I brought it to class and the Economics 1 class, and people just sort of stared at me, hey, what's the big deal? This is a chart that's just growing, what's the big deal? So I didn't think they quite got the message. So I said I was going to bring in a guest lecture next class. So I brought in a guest lecturer. At that point, it was my granddaughter who was 9 months old. So I walked in and she was held her in my arms. Cutest thing ever, right? And she somehow turns around, looks at that thing, and looks at me, sort of looks like she whispered in my ear. She couldn't talk, of course. And I said to everybody, she fixed it. She says, fix it. And that's effectively what we all want. But she's now six. I bring her back, it's the same chart. So we've got, but this is an example, if you like, and I think this is something to be worried about. Drag on growth, reason for slow growth, how is this gonna get resolved? Is it gonna be a big increase in taxes? Is it gonna be a reduction in spending? Or is the US gonna have trouble resurfacing its debt? So that's an example. Here's another example. This is the predictability of our tax code. This is the number of provisions in the tax code that expire in given years. And it's missing years because the government doesn't always get these numbers, and I can't update it completely. But you can see there's this big increase in the number of provisions that expire, number of parts of the tax code that are changing. So that's another example of, I'd say, that this is more the unpredictability of policy. This is a measure of the involvement of the, in this case, federal government in regulatory activities. Again, regulation is not necessarily a bad. We need regulation in many respects. But it also is a override of some market principles. This is just the number of federal workers employed in regulatory activities during part of this expansion. I exclude TSA employees because it would be much larger if I included them. And it's also not comparable for other periods. Here's the other period. This is the late 70s and early 80s. Not only was it lower, it was declining. So there's a difference here in the policies. This is this two different periods I'm talking about. It's quite a difference. And again, there's more information to show, but this is these three charts, including this one, are kind of a taste of what I mean. The different kinds of policies being followed. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about monetary policy, and to illustrate that, these changes, I want to look at this picture. This is a picture of the inflation rate in the United States going back to the mid-50s, and I have it here because I want to illustrate the change in monetary policy that I think is part of the problem, part of the issue. Okay, so how am I going to illustrate monetary policy in this picture? I'm going to draw in some measures of when the inflation rate was different levels. So 4% there. And then I'm going to put in values for the interest rate set by the Fed at different points on this line. So for example, in the bad old days of instability and rising inflation, the federal funds rate, the interest rate the Fed sets as part of its monetary operations, was 4.8%, and the inflation rate was 4%. So it was just a smidgen of real interest rates, 0.8%, very low. So perhaps not surprisingly, it didn't contain the inflation, and inflation continued to rise, and we had this terrible double-digit inflation period after the arrow pointing to the line. Same inflation rate in the 1980s, federal funds rate's twice as high. So that's a different policy. The economy is pretty much on the same keel, sort of in terms of capacity at the same time. But this is a shift, and I think this is a shift that's due to Volcker and Greenspan eventually, which was so much different what was going on in the earlier period with Martin and Burns. There was a shift back again, right? This is a back and forth thing, pendulum. Back again is illustrated here. Here's inflation rate at 2%. And I'm going to draw on two decisions points of the Fed. One is 97. The federal funds rate is 5.5%. So that's a, if you think about a real interest rate, that's 3.5%, 5.5 minus 2. And now look at what happened in 2003, 4, and 5. Same inflation rate, 2%. The interest rate is 1%. So it is a different policy. And I think to some extent, this is what I mean by policy getting off track. Interest rate is too low, not too high anymore, but too low. And a lot of the search for, a lot of the risk taking, I should say, the search that many investors had to find higher yields, but therefore more risky yields, came upon us. Search for yield, it's called. And so that's the change. So that's an example of my points. Economists have a way of illustrating this change using formula, using a formula, and one of the popular form is the so-called Taylor rule. So this is another way to illustrate it. This is, when I talk about the Taylor rule, I almost always refer to other people's work, so I have some credibility here. This is work by the Economist magazine back in 2007, and they show the actual interest rate by the Fed, which is in light blue, and the dark line is sort of where it should have been if the policy was like it was in the 80s and 90s. So it's too low. That's the point, it's too low. That's the kind of shift I'm talking about. Now this shift away from a predictable rule-like type of policies, which I characterize as the desired kind of policies for an economy that works well, continued. There were some actions that were taking place during the financial crisis, which were, I think, quite admirable by the Fed, kind of lender of last resort types of policies. And I want to illustrate that with this chart. This is a picture of what's called reserve balances, which are deposits that commercial banks hold at the Fed. So deposits of Bank of America at the Fed, for example. And when the Fed intervenes to provide loans to banks or other entities, it pays for that by increasing these reserves. And it's liquidity, basically, is another thing for this. Another name for this, just liquidity at the banks. So this little blip here, which I have to get close to show you, is the loans that the Fed gave in 9/11. 9/11 involved serious physical destruction in Wall Street. And so they gave loans to basically keep the markets working. And it came out right away. It was really a beautiful operation. That was $60 billion, if you look at the vertical axis, $60 billion. And so I think of that as good monetary policy. Then you had the financial crisis, 2008 panic, and they also provide loans. And these are, again, loans to banks, to some extent loans to foreign banks at this point. And it peaks here in the panic of late 2008. And then the facilities which were put in place to make these loans were no longer needed because the panic went away. And so it would have declined. That would also have been a beautiful operation if it ended. But in fact, this is what happened, okay? We had these quantitative easings, 1, 2, and 3, where the Fed bought huge amounts of mortgage-backed securities and treasury bills trying to stimulate the economy. And it's a long story about why. There's a long debate about whether this made any difference or not. But at the least, how can you think of that? This is a predictable rules-based policy. Very erratic, very unusual, and still under a great deal of debate. So don't worry about the details. Just think about this as a measure of what I'm trying to illustrate, that policy is different, and I would argue off track. One other point about monetary policy. This is another picture of one of those Taylor rules versus the Fed done by Bloomberg very recently, because there's a sense in which the debate recently about monetary policy is around the same issue. So this is a picture
of the actual federal funds rate that the Fed sets in the dark solid line. And first you can see this period here, which is the same as that other chart, interest rate too low by this measure, okay? And then it comes down just as you would like during the panic, very cutting interest rates because the economy is in recession. And then there's this tough period here where the interest rate hits zero. But then for the most part, for the last few years, this suggests an interest rate which is not zero, which is what the Fed did, but positive. And so the debate about whether the Fed should normalize or not has to do whether they should get back to something close like that dotted line. I think the fact that they're not is another example of deviating from predictable policies because we don't know what's coming next. And I think the last few weeks illustrate that uncertainty, maybe in other ways, but basically the point is the same. So that's the story about the US. Just maybe a couple of brief things about how this impinges on the rest of the economy, world economy. And then I'll make a few other points and stop. The US is not the only country with a central bank. We have the European Central Bank in Europe. We have the Bank of Mexico down south, the Bank of Canada. This is a picture of how that same measure of monetary policy performance would be in the countries in the Eurozone, the countries that use the euro. I didn't do this. This is done by the office, the OECD in Paris. And what they did is during the same period of going into the crisis, they looked at the differences between the interest rate that was actually applied by the European Central Bank, difference it says between the interest rate, and what this so-called Taylor rule would say. And they plotted that against the excesses in the housing market, basically change in housing investment as a percentage of GDP. And so it's the same thing as you see in the we saw in the US. The bigger the deviation from rules-based policy or the policy rule, the more speculation, the more problems were going on, in this case, in the housing market. And these are the countries that were worst hit. Ireland, Spain, and Greece are still being hit. So the European Central Bank was kind of doing the same thing. There could only be one interest rate for all these countries under the European Central Bank, but their conditions are different, and so these deviations are caused by that. The conditions of inflation and unemployment and output are different. So that's another example of this spreading globally. I think that there's a tendency not only for these different policies to move together in one country, but there's also now a tendency for the policies to be affected in other countries too, and that's what this is trying to show. Let me give you one more example of that. This is a chart from the Bank of International Settlements just done a month or so ago. And they are showing that the phenomenon I'm talking about is global, not just the Eurozone. So what they do is take a measure of the actual interest rate set. On the left, it's by all countries. On the right, by emerging market countries. In red, that's the actual interest rate. And then they show the interest rate that's suggested by this kind of policy rule, and other ones give the same kind of answer. And you can see about the same time they start to deviate, just like the Fed, and they're still deviating. It's a little bit more in emerging markets. So this spreads globally, and it's an interesting phenomenon. We don't know all the reasons for it, I've thought a lot about it, but it's something that you have to take into account, I think, in evaluating the story, because we do have some problems globally now, as well as in the US. Okay, I see I just have a few minutes left, and what I want to do is redress another issue which I've thought a lot about maybe since I wrote the book and maybe since I was supposed to come down here last February. You might buy the story that the economy was growing rapidly in the 80s and 90s, and it was great moderation. At least that's what I hope you can see in the data. You might also buy the story that I'm explaining here, that a lot of that has to do with policy. But you all might also say, but hey, weren't there some other things going on that are important? Wasn't the income distribution shifting in a direction so the rich were getting richer and by larger amounts? And isn't that something to think about too? And how does that fit into this theory you're telling us about economic freedom? What about those guys? GDP doesn't tell that whole story, and it's true. So that's what this, I'm just to say here. Yes, it was good, the economy was good, and a lot of people benefited from the low inflation and low unemployment. And it would be good to get back there. That's what I'm arguing, a change in policy would be best. But what about the income distribution? And in fact, a lot of talk about this in the last couple of years. This is a picture, one of the most famous pictures that illustrates this, by Emmanuel Saez, a professor at Berkeley. And he's showing, income share of the top 1% in the United States based on tax records. And you can see that in this period that I'm talking about, which I think is good, is the income distribution started to move, according to these data. Okay, and so you want to see, what's going on? Is this economic freedom also doing this stuff too while it's making a good economy? When you think about these data, as in all cases, you have to think about how valid they are. They come from the Internal Revenue Service, which means there's reporting issues. I think it's very important that an inequality of outcome, some people do real well, like Bill Gates, some people don't do well, that's not necessarily a problem. May reflect investment, luck, all sorts of things. Might be good for the economy. But if it reflects an inequality of opportunity, then it's a problem. Then it's something I at least would worry about. Income distribution doesn't tell you about the people at the bottom. It just tells you the percentage. And there's some positives of a widening income distribution. There's positives that people do very well. Philanthropy, for one example of that. And then finally, when you think about income distribution, you've got to recognize that there's the effect of the tax and transfer system. Taxes and transfers do affect it, but the change that I showed you in that picture, that increasing spread, is not due to taxes and transfers. It's almost all due to market income changing. And this is just a quick picture of that. One measure of inequality, also in that picture, is the Gini coefficient. The Gini coefficient is a measure, the higher the number, the more inequality there is. So this is a picture going back in history. This comes from the OECD, going back to the 70s up to the recent past. And the blue is the Gini coefficient based on just the market income before you tax and do welfare payments or other kinds of transfers. And you can see that's been increasing. That blue line's been increasing. And the red line's been increasing. But the gap between the two hasn't been changing. So the part that's due to the tax and transfer system is really pretty much steady. It's something else going on. It's returns that people are getting from work and investment. So what's the explanation for this? Well, I think it has a lot to do with policy again. I think it has a lot to do with economic freedom again, as I'll explain in a minute. To see that, take a look at this picture, which is derived from the same data that gives you the share earned by the top 1%. It's showing you the change in real income for people in the 90th percentile and the 10th percentile, the top 10%. And the picture's similar to what I showed you before, but it traces the actual real income growth for those two percentages. And don't forget, there's shifts between these two. You know, it's a usual problem in looking at income distribution, shifts of people between the two groups. But nonetheless, they tell a story in that a lot of the spread, at least in the 80s and 90s, and until recently, because unfortunately everybody's been, by this measure, not doing so great recently, the spread has had to do with a more rapid increase of the top, okay? And it's not that the bottom didn't increase, just not increase as much during the 80s and 90s. So it seems to me that you kind of want your explanation to have to do with why this happened. And I think it has a lot to do with education. And that's where I want to finish. If you look at the returns to education, they increased in the 80s and 90s. And this is a picture of that. This is the wage
of college graduates and students to get a master's degrees or other advanced degrees relative to those who don't get degrees at all. So it's you can see the purple line is with college graduates, and their relative earnings increasing quite rapidly in the 80s through this chart, which was put together by Kevin Murphy at the University of Chicago, showing an increase. So you by going to getting advanced degrees or just degrees, you're getting higher wages. And so that higher wage thing you saw, the top 10%, probably likely to do that. And graduate school, master's degrees, even better. It's pretty substantial. Maybe you think it should be more, but that's what the data show. Now, in most markets, this return would bring about an increase in the number of people going to college and graduate school. It would say, hey, there's a bigger return here, let's take advantage of that. But it looks like that's not happening. And this is, again, I'm not an expert in this, but due to work by Kevin Murphy. And I'm only going to show you one of these charts, one of these many charts. The one at the top gives you high school graduation rate by birth cohort. And you could see it increased greatly until birth cohort around 1950, and then it's basically been flat. Some of the others have increased. But this is an indication that despite the greater return, there's not been the supply response. And we don't know all the reasons for that. I think it's because we haven't given, in the US, the opportunity to all people, enough opportunity to do it. So what it comes down to my view is it becomes another economic freedom issue, because there's something about our delivery of educational services that's not creating economic freedom for everybody. And I'm going to conclude by just a few pictures or charts to illustrate that. Many of you know this, there's a lot of work going on, but there's a very famous movie put together called Waiting for Superman. Beautiful movie. And it's about five kids and their desire of their families to get them from a bad school to a better school, disadvantaged neighborhoods, et cetera. This is the probability they would have to get into the schools because of the queues and the lottery and the waiting lines. This is their pictures, if you want to remember. And some of them didn't make it, some of them did. But it's an indication that there is a huge demand if we could deliver to improve. These kids who don't get in don't have the same economic freedom as I've defined to take advantage of. And I think that's not the only answer, but a lot of the answer has to do with the income distribution issue we have seen. So just to wrap up, it seems to me that when we think about this idea of economic freedom and growth and stability, the big picture, you really want to think about it a little more widely. And think about the other things that come. So this is just my list. Too little economic freedom in education. Low graduation rates, low test scores. We know that, i.e. low wages, according to economic theory, basic economic theory. I mentioned a lot about regulation. Too much regulation can be a problem for the overall economy. Well, it can also be a problem for individuals. Regulatory capture refers to the situation where a regulatory agency is captured by the industry and starts to do what the industry wants. May hand out favors, maybe bend the rules, maybe help cronies. It can add, so it's unfair in that sense, but it also causes high risks, so macro issues as well. I haven't talked at all about this, but part of the deviations from good policy were all the bailouts, I think. What about, and it has to do with growth and stability. Well, they also affect income distribution, I think, in not great ways. It's, in this case, helps too big to fail firms. And I've emphasized this discretionary monetary policy, but maybe that has negative impacts too. It's not just slow growth and inflation or more instability. People that know what's going on at the Fed in a discretionary environment, not so clear, not so predictable, they can make a lot of money. Call that higher profits for insiders. And of course, a lot of the people who benefit from the low interest rate are matched by people who are hurt by the low interest rate, and they'd be retirees, and it may encourage more risk-taking. So these all these distribution effects that go on behind the scenes, I think it's important to take them into account when you're analyzing the overall economy. So I see my time. I'm just about right, Steve, in time. But just to conclude, renewal first principles, get back to the first principles. I think it helps overall economic performance. That's the whole point of this talk. But it will also help people at the bottom. If we're careful to spread this and make it economic freedom for all. And I know from talking and lecturing and discussing with people, a lot of this may sound counterintuitive. More freedom, how can that help? How can that help? And I think you have to look at the evidence. You have to think about economic theory. You have to think about what's happened in different countries, happened in the same country, different points in time. But there's a lot of evidence that this kind of thing works across countries and across states, across the same country at different points in time. And that's the basic message of my talk. So thank you.
We have a few minutes for questions. I'm going to hand the microphone over to Andy Taylor, and we'll raise your hand if you'd like to ask a question, and we have our first.
Professor Taylor, one of the imperatives in Econ 101 is that if interest rates are consistently below inflation rates, as the Taylor rule is sometimes invoked, and if a central bank blows up its balance sheet, as our Federal Reserve has done, and if government spending seems to be on a trajectory that's unsustainable, the projections would have been that we would have serious inflation by this time. And instead, we seem to be in a global disinflation, if not deflationary, environment. What do you think is the explanation for this?
I think first come to the conclusion that it's not stimulating the economy. You think about monetary policy as being inflationary. It's going to stimulate the economy. People start spending, and it drives up prices. This doesn't seem to be doing that. The economy isn't growing very rapidly. There isn't a lot of pressure on wages and prices yet. And so I think it's to me, an indication that monetary policy, these unusual policies, quantitative easing is not working. Purchasing mortgage-backed securities isn't working. Even these low interest rates, where you're stuck at zero for an indeterminate amount of time, may be not working. So I come, and then you look at Japan, looks like it's going into recession again. It's amazing. They've done all this quantitative easing. I hope it doesn't go into recession. So to me, that's kind of the issue here. It may sound counterintuitive, but that's what we're seeing. One of the reasons it doesn't seem to work is based on economic theory. I would teach my graduate students for years that the term structure of interest rates works in such a way that if this central bank tries to affect the price of a particular security, say corporate, or say government bonds, that the term structure is going to mean that they don't affect it. It's just they can't really move the market around. Maybe they can shock the market for a few days, but ultimately the interest rates are going to be determined by more fundamental issues. The quantitative easing sort of went against that theory and said, well, that's an old theory. We need a new theory, sometimes called preferred habitat, that certain investors like to be in this particular maturity of a security, so you can actually move it around. Hasn't seemed to have much effect. If you look at the effect of QE on long-term securities over time, they have not gone the direction. Long-term security interest rates have fallen a lot since QE ended. So I think there's a lot of sort of specific evidence why it doesn't work. Some of it we're just learning about. Another way to think about it is the reserve balance chart I showed, where it exploded with QE1, QE2, and QE3, that's all money held in the banks. Those are deposits of Bank of America, Wells Fargo, et cetera, at the Fed.
So that's not in people's hands. That's bank money. So that's not inflationary right there. So there's always been a risk of these policies, in my view. One is inflation, and there will be if it's not adjusted at some point. But the other risk is this downside risk, that it's not stimulating the economy. It's not having the effect that we hope. And I think there's, if you look at Federal Reserve officials' comments, they seem to change over time. For a while there, they were affecting the stock market, but that was never one of the purposes in the beginning, to affect the stock market. So I think there's a problem, I'm not saying your question is not a good one and not interesting and not important to do research on, but it seems to me there's pretty clear answers to it.
John, I'll let you
there's one
pick.
There, yeah. I'm sorry, yeah.
Could you please talk a little bit about the minimum wage and what its correlation is to the historical economy and what number you believe it should be at the moment?
Okay, so why don't you just think for a minute about the minimum wage in terms of my list of principles. So it is an intervention. It's going against the market. It's saying that people can't buy and sell labor at the market price, that they can't set a price below a certain number. So I would say, based on those principles, should be looking at it somewhat skeptically. The debate has moved to the point where people recognize it affects jobs negatively. CBO says an increase in the minimum wage will reduce jobs, but they say that's okay because there's a lot of people who are not affected by a loss of job or a loss of availability, and they're going to get more money. And so they say it's a trade-off, okay? I think it's a problem because I think the people who are hurt tend to be more disadvantaged than the people who are helped. The people who have trouble getting the job, people don't have the education, the people who are not second earners. And so that's what worries me. Of course, we can live with certain reasonable levels, but now what's interesting, when you're talking about $15 an hour, which is a lot of people are talking about it, and they're getting well-meaning, what's interesting to me, a lot of the people who are pushing that are asking for exemptions. Like unions who are pushing the $15 wage are asking for exemptions from it for some of their workers, because they know it affects employment. So higher prices that firms have to pay affect poor people in many cases. So those are some of the downsides. I think it's an interesting question of what's happened in this debate over time. Teaching Economics 1 used to be just straightforward, minimum wages. Be concerned about a minimum wage. We can understand the arguments, but here's my supply and demand curve. You decide. The debate's changed a lot. So when I say that now, I got to have all these qualifications, all these explanations of why our governor, Governor Brown, did this, and all the politics and the backs and forth. So I think it's an issue that still should be addressed, and we should think about it. It's political in many respects. You can't always get exactly the policy you want. You can't always get the education system improved, which would be better. So you might be stuck with some of these things. And it's really not very partisan anymore. A lot of Republicans are, in states especially, are suggesting higher minimum wages. But I would think about it and think if there's better ways to help people who you're trying to help.
Oh, actually, he beat you to it, even though you're closer.
Thank you. Hi. So one of your first principles is less regulation for government. One of my questions was, I'd argue that during the 2007 financial crisis, more regulation on mortgage-backed securities and CDOs would have actually lessened the problem. So I'm wondering what your thoughts are on that.
So let me understand the question a little bit. So which kind of regulations are you concerned about?
Regulations on mortgage-backed securities, CDOs, credit default swaps.
Okay. I would say, just as a generalized statement, the problem in most of the financial markets was not insufficient regulations, but insufficient enforcement of existing regulations. So I don't want to say it applies to every single thing you just mentioned. But if you think about banks, heavily regulated institutions, many regulators, the regulators and supervisors of the New York Fed on the premises of the money center banks, and we find out later a lot of risk-taking going on, more than would be prudent under the existing laws. And so it makes you think, well, it's not the laws, it's the enforcement, and how can you get your hand around that better? That's the regulatory capture issue. So I happen to think a lot of it is that. Not all of it, for sure. I think there's some questions about how an institution designed to regulate savings and loans institutions was regulating a gigantic investment firm owned by an insurance company, and that branch of AIG had a lot of problems, but it was being regulated by an institution designed to regulate thrift institutions. So that's obviously a problem. That's been fixed by Dodd-Frank. At least the institution has been merged with another institution, another regulatory institution. One more thing, I think there's some of the regulations that have been put in, especially in credit markets, don't seem to me to be based on the crisis. So we've put in place a Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. It's actually housed at the Federal Reserve. Its budget comes from seniorage. It comes from the Fed's budget. There's no appropriation associated with that. Makes you wonder in the first place about checks and balances. But a lot of its activity, some of its activity, is to regulate payday loans. Your payday loans where you get a loan to extend your ability to spend things at payday. I'm not saying that's a good activity, and I'm not saying there aren't people who charge too much interest rates there, but what's that going to do with the financial crisis? And so we've had a lot of those things come into play, which came in because of the crisis, don't have much to do with the crisis, but they're more regulation. I think if you look at carefully, a lot of those, they're harmful to people. One of the things which I had to do in government was evaluate various kinds of microloan facilities in developing countries. Microloan businesses charged huge interest rates, but they were a way for these small businesses to get funds and start going, and they covered a lot of risk. Those interest rates were based on risk. So it would be terrible to slap fines on people like that for charging too high interest rates. So it's a complicated question, but I think these generalizations I'm putting forth are a way to begin looking at it.
So we assume that the Fed are honest brokers and actors. The question around QE2, QE3, QE4 is why? Is it as simple as the world simply couldn't buy that much U.S. debt? What was the rationale for such loose policy?
Okay, so several rationales have evolved. I think the initial one was, if we go in and buy mortgage-backed securities, we'll drive down those interest rates and it'll be easier for the housing market to get started. So that sort of follows, right? You buy mortgage-backed securities, and that goes in that direction. I've done some work on that. It seems it didn't have as much effect as you might think. In fact, really no effect. So that's sort of after the fact. But you're asking for why they did it, and I think that's part of the why. They thought they were driving down interest rates in the long end of the market or particular sectors. A related part of this is you saw in one of my charts how the interest rate, even by a Taylor rule, hit zero. It was coming down and it hit zero, not for that long a time by my calculation, but for a while. So what do you do then? You can't really easily have negative interest rates. So they say, well, let's go do something else. Let's buy government bonds. At least we can drive down long-term rates. So it's the same goal, but it's motivated by the fact that the short-term interest rates hit zero lower bound. So that's another reason. My alternative to that would have been when it hits a zero bound, you try to keep money growth constant, but that's not what they did. They want to do something else, but you're asking about why. I think once you get started on these things, it's hard to reverse. In my experience in public policy, you got something going, and it's you don't want to reverse it, and you're worried about reversing it. So one way to understand that is in 2013, I'm not sure I have my dates exactly right, around May or June, the chairman of the Fed was asked by the Joint Economic Committee members about when QE might end. It was in QE3. And he used the word in the next few meetings, somewhere in that conversation, in the next few meetings. And it scared lots of people. Emerging markets, securities started moving around, and I was at the BIS in Switzerland at the time, and a lot of the central bank governors from other countries were on their leaving, not coming, on their iPhones. And so that had an impact. And so it made the Fed back off. And they did. They eventually did, I think, a pretty good tapering. That was called the taper tantrum. They eventually did a more strategic tapering, which worked better. But they're nervous about that. Now they're nervous about reducing the size of the balance sheet. That big increase in reserves is still there. It's not going up, but it's not going down. None of these answers apply, though, to the period before the crisis, when I also argued that rates were too low, 2003, 4, and 5. And there is more of a puzzle about what happened. My own view, and I know the people, Alan Greenspan I've known for many, many years. I used to work for his firm in New York. And he disagrees with me, obviously, on this. I think that a lot of it had to do with they're trying to do too much. The expression is sometimes called the perfect becomes the enemy of the good. They had a good record for the 80s and 90s until this period. And I think that he or they or somebody felt that holding rates a little extra low for a while would be kind of insurance against a badder outcome, a worse outcome, I should say. And so that's another reason. It's also not that far from 9/11. And all the different things that could be affecting the economy related to that. So I don't know. Those are just a bunch of reasons, and Federal Reserve officials have given some of these at certain points in time. But ultimately, it comes down to learning from that experience as best we can and trying to, if you agree it was a problem, try to fix the problem and not worry so much about why it was made. I think it was different viewpoints from different people. Even now, when they go back and say why we did this, there's different explanations from different people who were there making the decisions at the time. But it's economic history is fascinating. Unfortunately, as we get further away from it, the less information we have. So this is a good time to study it and ask questions of people.
I was wondering, given the arguments against the minimum wage as well as the dangers you've suggested of government overregulation with social programs and other things, what your thoughts were on a guaranteed minimum income instead?
Guaranteed minimum income?
Yes, like Milton Friedman proposed.
Okay. Well, Milton Friedman imposed a negative income tax. Right, and negative income tax was that you would actually, below a certain income, you wouldn't pay tax, you'd receive a transfer payment. And it's simple, he liked it. He simultaneously said repeal all of our welfare programs completely, so it'd just be based on this measure. I don't know, in retrospect, we try to do a little bit of that. There's this earned income tax credit, which is available to people with families, and they get a payment rather than have to pay taxes. I think that's trying to deal with these problems, trying to deal with the safety net problems, and you need to deal with this. There is a safety net issue to deal with. I think the problem that now with the way these has been implemented is there's actually a pretty high marginal tax as you come off of these programs because you're losing those payments as you increase your income. And so that's a disincentive to work. There's some aspects of the Affordable Care Act that have the same thing. You lose your health subsidy as you earn more income, so that discourages people from work. At least it makes it higher tax. So I think simple things like Friedman was arguing are definitely worth thinking about, and something for a safety net is worth thinking about. It's very complicated now, and it's a huge number of differences of opinion, but I think all those things are worthwhile taking a careful look at. But the beauty of a lot of Milton Friedman's proposals was their simplicity. He recommended all the Fed needed to do was keep money growth constant, and everything would be fine. So it's more complicated, but the idea of starting with those ideas and working at them, I think, is valuable. And so people who do that, and like he did, makes you think a lot about improving. It's not, you just don't take everything as a given. Don't take the market system as a given. You're thinking about ways to improve on and work on it, and I think that was productive. But got a long way to go.
Well, thank you, John.
Okay.
Thank you for a wonderful evening.
Okay.